Nobody's even talking to the average person in America. They're going to be blindsided. They're not going to see this stuff coming.
I'll give you a good example of a good actor and a proactive, positive action taken by Amazon. Not surprisingly, I think, actually. So Amazon has undergone an effort to train tens of thousands of its employees on machine learning, a form of artificial intelligence, over the course of the next several years. Most people don't know this, but Amazon is one of the most prolific artificial intelligence companies on Earth. They use it pervasively throughout their entire business, everything from their logistics business to, I don't know, have you ever been in one of their Go stores? It's extraordinary. You walk into the front of the door, you open your Amazon application, you scan it through the gate, you walk in, take a bag, take things off the shelf, whatever you want, and you just walk out the store. You do nothing. You do nothing. Because the entire store is wired with computer vision. It knows exactly which products you take. It already knows who you are because it's recognized your face. And when you walk out, your account is charged instantly. Completely frictionless. There are no cashiers in the store. The thing with Bitcoin is they're not anonymous transactions.
Mm-hmm.
It's an immutable database, an immutable ledger. You can see exactly which transaction you made on any given day. And from the beginning of time.
Mm-hmm.
So no transaction is secret whatsoever.
But isn't
that attractive for a government?
Religious people would call that the mark of the beast.
Right.
Where you cannot buy, sell without being known, no secrets, all open and controlled by a central power that can find you, track you, do all of it. I mean, all the things that I remember as a kid being raised in a religious school that was crazy, that'll never happen. It's all here. That's what this is.
It is happening.
And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name.
Times of universal deceit. Telling the truth is a revolutionary act. I gave you a little bit too much truth, and now I must be silenced. Banned by Facebook, banned by Instagram, and now the media says Louis Farrakhan is far right. What? They obviously banned Farrakhan at the same time to give them the excuse that this wasn't political. It was totally political. This is nothing less than election meddling. Everyone Facebook has banned was instrumental in getting Donald Trump elected. This is punishment. This is a political purge. This has nothing to do with hate or violating terms of service. They're now removing people's ability to have bank accounts and credit cards because they have the wrong opinions. They're literally trying to remove your right to buy and sell. This is biblical. No right to commerce unless you have the mark. And what is the mark? Total intellectual castration and obedience. So surprised to see conservative thinkers like James Woods banned from Twitter and Paul Watson banned from Facebook. Donald J. Trump retweeted your tweet. Thank you, Mr. President. Very cool. But while tweets are nice, we need action. A handful of giant corporations have seized control of the new public square and are digitally disappearing.
Authentication is irritating. In fact, it's so irritating only about half the people do it, right? Despite the fact that there's a lot of information about you on your smartphone, which makes you far more prone to identity theft than if you didn't otherwise have it there, right?
So you're talking about passwords and pins and the drawing patterns and
Android. Sure, look, after 40 years of advances in computation, we're still authenticating basically the same way we did years ago. In fact, it's gotten worse, because now you don't do it once a day or twice a day. The average user does it 39 times a day, and it takes them 2.3 seconds every time they do it. Power users would do it up to 100 times a day. So what are we doing about that? Well, we're thinking of a whole variety of options for how you could do better at authentication. So you can start with nearer term things like tokens or fobs that might have NFC or Bluetooth embedded in them, but you can also think about a means of authentication that you could simply wear on your skin every day for a week at a time, say an electronic tattoo. Now, we're talking about wearables. Everybody's interested in wearables. I'm profoundly interested in wearables. And what I will tell you is that there are some, we've made a lot of advances in wearables, but there's still some fundamental problems that we haven't solved. Like one of them is the mechanical mismatch between humans and electronics, right? So electronics are boxy and rigid, humans are curvy and soft. That's a mechanical mismatch problem. Well, a researcher at the University of Illinois, his name is Dr. Rogers, what he discovered is that he could use standard CMOS techniques to make islands of high-performance silicon connected by accordion-like structures that would allow it to stretch up to 200% and still be performing. And what he did is he founded a company and they started making electronic tattoos. So I'm wearing one here on my arm.
Do we have a camera to get a...
This is a developmental system made by MC10. And it has an antenna and some sensors embedded in it. And what we plan to do is work with them to advance a tattoo that could be used for authentication. Now, it may be true that 10 to 20-year-olds don't want to wear a watch on their wrist, but you can be sure that they'll be far more interested in wearing an electronic tattoo, if only to piss off their parents. Right?
Most of us were rounded up, put in camps for orderly disposal. Spread by laser scanner. Some of us were kept alive to work. Loading bodies. The disposal units ran night and day. We were that close to going out forever.
What's happening now, it's really a watershed in the history of surveillance. First of all, we see mass surveillance systems entering and being adopted in democratic countries which previously resisted them. Secondly, we see the nature of surveillance changing from over-the-skin surveillance to under-the-skin surveillance. Over-the-skin surveillance is, say, the government or a corporation watching, monitoring where you go, what you buy, what you watch on television. Under the skin surveillance starts with monitoring your body temperature and blood pressure, but ultimately it's about hacking your body and brain and knowing what you're feeling each and every moment, not just pain or coughing, but you know, our emotions are a biological phenomena exactly like the flu. Or like heat, like temperature. So if you have a surveillance system that can tell you if somebody is sick, that same surveillance system can also tell you how they feel each and every moment. And just, you know, 10 years in the future, fast forward, North Korea, every citizen has to wear a biometric bracelet on the arm, and you have to watch this big speech by big leader. And when you watch the speech, they are watching what's happening in your body. You can smile and you can clap your hands, but if you're angry, they know. You have no control over what's actually happening in your body. So this is no longer science fiction. This is already within reach of present day technology. And the coronavirus epidemic can be this watershed event when governments going under our skin becomes acceptable.
And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666.
But then I asked the same question that everybody else has asked, and I said, Lord, we're going to rely on my Bible study as to understand what the end time is. Why should they listen to me? I mean, why is my, you know, in fact, I'll tell you exactly what my prayer was. I said, oh God, I'm a pebble splash in a sea of ideas. I go, plink. Okay, that's Monty Judah's contribution to the whole end time scenario understanding. Hi. So I said, Lord, look, that's not going to work. If you don't strengthen me to do the task, I'm not able. If you don't give me the understanding, how can I share the understanding with anyone else? If you don't teach me, how will I know? And it was a very serious, personal conversation. And that's when I suddenly saw some things there that I hadn't seen before. There's these men of insight, and they, the ones that do have the understanding, and here's the three signs. And I went looking around to see if anybody had this information, and where's it at? I can't find it in any commentary or whatever. And I started looking, and I'm hearing all kinds of flaky explanations for these things. Mostly, people just ignore them and don't even want to talk about them. And I went through a lot of stuff, and I found out, you know, this is relatively unknown. Well, the first one that intrigued me was the calculating of the beast, because the word calculate is the same Greek word that we use now for computers. Well, I was a young man. We were just getting computers going. In fact, I was the first engineer in my company to bring a desktop computer into the workplace and actually start using it in work. And I made my career on that. I was the guy that started bringing desktop computing into my workplace. Built the first word processing center in my company. By the way, we are a very high technology engineering company. And I was on that cutting edge, and that's how I made my career, was off of that emerging technology. Well, once I get the computer and say, well, how would I calculate the number of the beast? And so I'm going, well, is there different counting systems? In the world, and after you get into computers, you find out there's all kinds of counting systems. And I found that the Hebrews have this ancient counting system. It's called gematria. Been around for years. Other languages have used it. The Greeks use it. Others have used it. It's very common knowledge to anybody that gets into Hebrew thinking, Hebrew teaching, and the Torah, because the Torah uses it. Pretty simple system. There's a certain value for each letter of the alphabet. You put a name in, it kicks out a numerical value. So I wrote a computer program that would do that. I could punch any name or combination of words in it. It would give me the gematria numerical value for it. The day I finished the program, I'm loading in names of world leaders all over the world on it, and one name hit. One name came out exactly to that value. Now, I got to tell you, the thing was set up in English because English doesn't have numerals, and that's the reason why we applied the gematria system. I said, you know, I need to take this back to Hebrew. I need to go all the way back to the original language. What is his name in Hebrew, and calculated in the Hebrew letters, what does it equal? So I did. His number is 666 when he's translated even into Hebrew. No matter what system you put in, it comes out 666. Do you know what the odds are of multiple languages coming up with the same thing on this deal? You'd have to go off in the universe for eons to even get close to it. And there's this guy in this world who's operating, who's my age. Matter of fact, I was born about 6 months after him. And all of his life has been dedicated to one purpose. The guy's name is Prince Charles of Wales.
Now, to vanish into thin air and leave not a carbon footprint behind.
What is thy bidding, my master?
There is great disturbance in the force.
I felt it.
We have a new enemy.
Now, time to introduce Prince Charles, but not as you know him. This morning, the Prince is addressing an energy conference in the Middle East, but he won't actually be there. He's appearing as a hologram, a recorded three-dimensional figure. Now, those behind the technology say it'll soon be possible for people to appear virtually from anywhere in the world, like myself. That would be a good idea. That would save some early starts. But what it does save is the vast carbon emitted by flying people around the place. Our environment correspondent, Catherine Jacob, reports.
To vanish into thin air and leave not a carbon footprint behind.
He may not be known as the most modern of men, but his concern for the environment has catapulted Prince Charles straight into the 21st century. He's been transformed into a hologram for a virtual speech at an energy conference in Abu Dhabi. If he'd appeared in person, his long-haul flight would have emitted around 15 tons of carbon.
Prince Charles is a real problem. I think he's got some very strange views of the world and very strange